Hello. Hi, a very good evening to you all. Today we are back with our class number 21. And today's topic is HDR brachytherapy physics. And for that, we have with us Dr. Jamema Swamidas. She's a professor in the Department of Medical Physics at Tata Memorial Center, Mumbai. Jamema Madam has multiple publications on the various aspects of the medical physics associated with brachytherapy. And she is currently an ISTRO faculty as well, and has organized and moderated a number of ISTRO courses around the country. Jamema Madam, you can start now.
Thank you, Dr. Sayan, for that kind introduction. We will be now looking at a very brief introduction and the overview of the brachytherapy. This is actually a very big module, but I will try to cover as much as possible in this 1 hour. I will also be skipping some slides if there is any additional, just a moment. Yeah, I'm sorry. Okay, so let us proceed. The overview will cover basic brachytherapy principles, radiation safety, and 2D brachytherapy, its rational, and also transition to 3D image-based brachytherapy for cervical cancer. When it comes to brachytherapy, generally 90% of our practice is about cervical cancer. There are also about other sites like breast or head and neck, soft tissue sarcoma, that which actually covers only 10%. So whenever we talk about brachytherapy, at least in our country, it is mostly about cervical cancer. And I'm going to take this as a case example to illustrate the application of brachytherapy. The specific learning objectives would be, because this is going to be a teaching lecture, so I will...
Madam, I'll just interrupt you once. Please share your screen.
Okay. Just a moment. Yeah, can you see the screen?
Yes, madam.
Okay, sorry about that.
Yeah, perfect.
Okay, so these are going to be the specific learning objectives where we will be discussing about the type of brachytherapy. Most importantly, what are the sources that are available and its characteristics, the source strength specification, those calculation models, and also principles of brachytherapy of cervical cancer, and also some limitations of 2D and why do we have to move on to 3D image-based brachytherapy, and then also a quick look at the radiation safety principles, because this was prepared for the physicist and I thought that it would be also helpful for the radiation oncologist community. So as we all know that brachytherapy is nothing but it is a short distance treatment of cancer with small encapsulated radionuclide sources, and treatment is generally given by placing the sources directly into or near the volume to be treated. And high dose can be delivered to the tumor with the rapid fall off of the surrounding normal tissue. And this is the advantage of brachytherapy. And generally, the dose distribution in brachytherapy is governed by inverse square law, unlike external beam brachytherapy. And that is the power of brachytherapy. Based on the type of the brachytherapy, it can be divided into four approaches. One is, let us say, in terms of approach to the target, we can have different types of brachytherapy, such as intracavitary, interstitial, intraoperative, intraluminal, intravascular or mold technique. And when it comes to dose rate, we have high dose rate, medium, low, and pulse dose rate. And in terms of source loading techniques, we have pre-loading, manual loading, and remote afterloading. And in terms of implant duration, we have temporary and permanent implants. So let us take a quick look at each one of these. So what is intracavitary brachytherapy? When the radioactive sources are placed in an existing cavity, usually inside a predefined applicator with special geometry, it is called intracavitary brachytherapy. Mostly it is used for uterine, cervix, or endometrium or vagina. When the radioactive sources are directly inserted surgically into the tissue, such as a head and neck implant or breast implant or soft tissue sarcomas, they are called interstitial brachytherapy. And the tumor or the implant volume is demarcated and the needles are inserted into the tissue under general or local anesthesia. And these needles, which are then replaced by the plastic catheters. And these are the intraoperative brachytherapy. The sources are implanted into the target tissue during the surgery. So this is an example of the soft tissue sarcoma, where you can see that the tumor is surgically excised, and then you are positioning your needles, and which are replaced by the plastic catheters. And this is an example of intraluminal brachytherapy, where the radioactive sources are placed in the lumen areas of the body, generally in the in a line geometry. The body sites could be esophagus, bronchus, nasopharynx, or rectum. Intraluminal brachytherapy consists of inserting the catheters in the lumen areas of the body. The most commonly used is esophagus. And intravascular brachytherapy, although is not very commonly practiced in our country, I'll just put it here for the sake of completion. You can visualize that a single source is generally placed into a small or large arteries, and the catheter-based delivery of radiation is to prevent the stenosis or after angioplasty. This is not a very common practice. Maybe from the academic point of view, you can just have a look at it later, because I didn't want to delete this slide. And next is one of the most, I would say, commonly used, at least in Tata Memorial Hospital, is mold brachytherapy for surface tumors such as basal cell carcinomas and other tumors, where you can see that the radioactive sources are placed over the tissue that is to be treated. And this is a diagram that illustrates the surface applicator, and the activity is arranged on the plane A. And to treat the plane A, you have to have the sources placed on the A prime, and they are separated by a distance H. Then there are certain specific rules of how to do the dosimetry and other things, which we will not go into the details now. This is based on source loading techniques. We have pre-loading, manual, and remote afterloading. And again, these are quite historical techniques, for example, pre and manual afterloading. In pre-loading, you have the applicators already loaded with the radionuclei, and that has resulted in a lot of exposure of the staff who are handling these radioactive substances. So this was discarded, followed by manual afterloading, where the radionuclei are loaded after the applicators are put in patient. And then the applicators are positioned to check radiographically to check using the radioactive markers or source dummies. And then the sources are introduced later after the dosimetry or planning. But now we have what is known as the remote afterloader. Everything is computer controlled. We don't have this mechanism of handling the radioactive substance manually. So in remote afterloading, the sources are driven from an intermediate safe into the implant using a remote-controlled computer-based control console. And it is most commonly used now, and the other two techniques are almost obsolete. And this is an example of a remote afterloading machine. This is just to give you a quick look at different parts. As you can see that this is an emergency button that you will see when you open the covers. The most important is the source safe here, holding the source. And this is the opto pair that will verify the source position, because that's the most important part of the high dose rate brachytherapy machine. And this is the indexer phase with the different source channel. And this is an indexer which actually drives the source to a particular controlled tube. And there will be a radiation monitor to see what are the radiation levels each time the source is driven out. And this is the most important part, which is a stepper motor. As you may be knowing that one of the most powerful tool of remote afterloader is the optimization, which is possible because of this stepper motor, which can move the miniature source by about a millimeter or so. And because of that, we are able to get a different dwell time, so that we are able to optimize the dose distribution. So this is just to give you a quick look at how this is going to be, especially the simple architecture of the remote afterloader. And when we were actually comparing of what is the advantages and disadvantages of remote afterloading. Of course, there are a lot of advantages over the disadvantages because when there was a transition between a preloaded applicator and afterloaded applicator, there used to be a lot of debate about the cost of the machine. And of course, now the cost is no more an issue. The advantages of remote afterloading machine is that the major advantage is that it reduces the exposure to the medical personnel. And as I was telling earlier, optimization is one of the most important, powerful tool of remote afterloading. Treatment techniques can be made more consistent, and they are reproducible, and sources can be retracted into the shielded position to allow better patient care. Based on the implant duration, the implants can be divided into temporary or permanent implant. In temporary implant, the dose is delivered over a short period of time and the sources are removed after the prescribed dose has been reached. An example could be iridium, and it provides better control of the source distribution and dosimetry. And in permanent implants, on the other hand, generally it is done in prostate. A dose is delivered over the lifetime of the source until complete decay. Example could be iodine-125Cs for prostate. And it's a one-time procedure, and it is a preferred method for some tumors, such as prostate. Again, from the academic point of view, how the dose rates are defined. Although we practice the high dose rate in our country, which is about more than 10 to 12 gray per hour, there are also most of the centers in Europe who practice pulse dose rate, which is of the order of 1 gray per hour. Low dose rate is generally termed as less than 1 gray per hour, and medium dose rate is about 1 to 10 gray per hour, which is really not used. But this is again for the sake of academic purpose, I put it here. Just note that high dose rate is more than 10 gray per hour. This is how the LDR machine looked like. This is a historical picture. And we worked in this machine for quite some time, and this is not available anymore. This is obsolete, but just for the historical purpose. Now, this is one of the modern high dose rate brachytherapy machine that we use currently. This picture is from Elekta, and we also have other commercial suppliers now from other companies. This is just a representation of the machine. So one advantage, as I was telling, optimization is possible, and it can also be moved from one room to the other room, provided you have a sufficient shielding. So this is the sleek and a very small machine that can be moved depending on the availability of radiation protection issues. about pulse dose rate. Now, in high dose rate, you use radioactivity of 10 curie, but in pulse dose rate, you use a radioactive source of 1 curie. And source optimization also is possible as in high dose rate. And one advantage of pulse dose rate over high dose rate is that it mimics favorable radiobiology as compared to LDR. Now, when HDR was introduced somewhere in the year late 90s, there was a lot of criticism on radiobiology that it is not favoring as compared to LDR. But then later on, it has been proven that it does not result in new toxicities as compared to LDR. But however, there are now new school of thoughts where people believe that PDR is equivalent to LDR and it mimics the radiobiology of the LDR. I'm not going to the details now. And another disadvantage of pulse dose rate is that the treatments are generally of about 25 to 30 hours and the patient requires hospitalization, unlike high dose radiotherapy where it can be used as a as an outpatient procedure. This is the most important slide. What must be the properties of an ideal brachytherapy source? And there are various points that needs to be talked about. One is the photon energy. It should be low to medium. And but at the same time, it should be high enough to treat the target with homogeneous dose. Because if it is low energy, then you will not get the uniform dose to the target. And it should also be low enough to avoid damage to the normal tissues to minimize the radiation protection problem. So it has to be you know, optimally chosen. And half-life has to be, for a temporary implant, a long half-life is desirable. And for permanent implantation, a fairly short half-life is essential. And in terms of specific activity, you need to have a source which is as small as possible so that you can put it in the body cavities and you will be able to put it in you know, miniature catheters, which can also be used for, you know, let's say intraluminal applications. And it should be a pure gamma emitter because betas and alphas are too short in range and results in high doses to small volumes around the sources. And also it requires extra shielding to absorb these particles. And finally, there should not be any gaseous disintegration daughter products of radioactivity because that will lead to toxicity. And these are some of the sources, radionuclides used in brachytherapy. You can see I have listed out, you know, there's a whole lot of sources, but currently cobalt-60, iridium and iodine-125 are the most commonly used ones. And these are all the physical characteristics in terms of half-life, photon energy and the half-value layer in terms of lead. And all the other sources are discontinued due to safety reasons. For example, radium and radon is discontinued due to safety reasons. But they have a very strong influence of modern brachytherapy, which we will see later. Among these three isotopes of cobalt-60, iridium and iodine-125, iridium-192 is the most commonly used in high-dose rate brachytherapy. However, cobalt-60 also is being increasingly used now because a new company, BBIC, introduced the cobalt-60 and now it is becoming quite popular. This is a decay scheme of cesium. I'm skipping this. Later on, you can, if you want, you can have a look at it. We will see more about iridium. Iridium is available in the form of wires. It used to be in the form of wires. And the radioactive core being iridium platinum alloy with an outer sheath of 0.1 millimeter thick platinum. In addition to that, iridium-192 sources are also available as seeds, doubly encapsulated with an outer sheath of stainless steel and as strands of nylon ribbon, which is what we use. And high dose rate afterloading units are specially designed iridium sources with the typical activities of 10 curie, or in modern units, we can say 370 gigabecquerel. In terms of how the decay scheme, how does it produce? It is produced by bombarding iridium-191 with thermal neutrons in the reactors by neutron capture. So the cross-section of neutron capture has to be very high, and that is why these iridium-190 sources are very expensive, because they need to be positioned in the nuclear reactor with a high neutron flux to get a very good specific activity, such as 7760 curie per gram. This is the decay scheme of iridium-192. For the sake of physicist, it was given in quite detail, but I don't know from radiation oncology perspective whether it is relevant or not. But I think it's always good to know. Iridium-192 decays by emitting beta particles and gamma radiation. About 96% of the iridium decays occur via beta and gamma radiation, leading to platinum. Some of the beta particles are captured by other iridium nuclei, which are then converted to osmium. An electron capture is responsible for the remaining 4% of the iridium-192 decay. And iridium-192 is also a very strong gamma emitter and is doubly encapsulated with stainless steel to absorb this beta emission. That is why you would see the outermost shell of made of stainless steel. And this is a schematic diagram. There are many source designs available. This is just one example of what will be the source design. As you can see here, this is the iridium-192 core, and this is the steel capsule to cut off the beta particles. And this is a steel cable, which is very well welded. And then you have the source cable. The length of the source is, the outer length is 4.5 millimeter, and the inner length is 3.5. And if you see the thickness, outer thickness is 0.9 millimeters. So it's really quite miniature in size. And so we are able to drive these sources in catheters such as 6 French catheters, so that optimization is possible. There are also various commercially available iridium-192 sources are available. And it is important for us to know that which source you are using, because if you do not know what kind of source you are using, you will end up having wrong dosimetry. So from the physics perspective, this is important that you must know that what kind of source you are using. Accordingly, you will use proper dosimetric parameters, which we'll see later. I'm also not going into the detail here. Now, this is going to be a most important slide. I think in most of the bio nowadays, these questions, this question is asked that for the modern brachytherapy, which radionuclide is preferred and why? Is this cobalt-60 or iridium? You can see in terms of isodose distribution, there's not much difference between the existing commercial design of cobalt-60 and iridium-192. So that's a very important point, first one. Cobalt-60 may be used as an effective alternative for iridium-192 cervix brachytherapy, because earlier in LDR era, the cobalt-60 sources used to be very thick. And iridium-192 became popular because the specific activity is very high, and so they became miniature. But now, because of the technology, we are able to make cobalt-60 also as a miniature source as compared to iridium. And in addition to that, the specific activity also is comparable. But one disadvantage of cobalt-60 is that the shielding requirements are high because the energy is high. And there are also significant logistical and financial benefits of using the longer half-life of cobalt-60, as we all know, that 5 years as compared to 74 days. But there is one disadvantage, is that there is a specific number of cycles that are permitted by the companies, let's say, for example, FDA or something, which will restrict. So if you are in a very busy center, you have to use iridium because you will use this 10,000 cycles very quickly. But on the other hand, if you're having a very less patient load, then COBOL 60 would be a better choice because you will not consume these 10,000 cycles. That is about which source is better for high dose radiation therapy. And then how do you specify the source? So you can see that earlier we were specifying the source in terms of its content. On the left, you can see this mass of radium, equivalent mass of radium, or activity or apparent activity, not anymore. And now we have two important units. Again, this is a very important parameter in terms of Viva. Generally, we ask our physics residents, what is, how do you specify the source? So now the specification is not by content, but by means of how much it emits. So the definition is, it's called reference air karma rate or air karma strength. So reference air karma rate and air karma strength are the most recommended term of specification of source, and all the other are no longer in use. And we will see why. I'm again skipping this slide because they are not in use, but you must know. So later on offline, you can go and review these definitions. This is a very good material available from IAEA website. You can download them freely. These are contributed from across different, across the world from various brachytherapy experts, and including me. You can pick it up and you can read, you can use them for your examination. But currently I'm just skipping this. This is just to let you know that what are the previous historical source specifications. So now we use what is known as reference air karma rate. So reference air karma rate is nothing but it is the air karma rate in air at a reference distance of 1 meter. So that becomes like an SI unit corrected for air attenuation and scattering. Now these are very important because all the other confusions are now removed, because earlier if you see all the old units, there used to be a lot of confusion, but not anymore. Now it is very standard because they are using now SI unit. SI unit is gray per second and at 1 meter. It is convenient to use micro gray per hour for LDR and milli gray per hour for HDR. And later on, it has come in a different name, which is called air karma strength. It is one and the same, but the air karma strength definition was introduced so that it allows the measurement of the source strength based on air karma rate at a distance, at short distance other than 1 meter. Because if you see the previous reference air karma rate, the definition is at 1 meter. And because of that, there used to be some logistical problem. But now air karma strength is used to only measure the source strength other than 1 meter at shorter distances by multiplying the square of the distance, thus making the quantity distance independent. So I hope that you understand what I mean by that. So reference air karma rate and air karma strength, both are one and the same, but air karma strength is distance independent, where you can see this is it is getting multiplied by the square of the distance. And so all the other units almost remain the same. Now let us come to a most important part of how do you calculate the dose. From the physics perspective, it is very important. So we actually go through these slides much more in detail. But for the radiation oncologists community, I think it is still important to know how the dose is getting calculated so that you will know, but not too much in detail. This is the schematics of the TG43 formalism. And this is the source with the, in the, this is, we call it, this is the along the axis. and this is across the axis. And let us assume that P is the point where we wanted to calculate the dose. So we take the polar angle here, R is the distance, and theta is the angle that it is subtended by this point to the center of the source. And you can see all the other parameters. L is the length of the inner core, and R is the distance between the center of the source and the point of our interest. So in this geometry, the formalism is nothing but dose at a point P, R and theta is nothing but the multiplication of, you can see this is air karma strength, this is dose rate constant, and this is the geometric function, and this is the radial dose function, and this is the anisotropic function. So what does what do we mean by all these things? We will let, we'll go through now. We know that what is the air karma strength. Air karma strength is nothing but the reference air karma rate at 1 meter multiplied by the distance at 1 meter. So what about the dose rate constant? So the next is dose. The next is a dose rate constant. So dose rate constant depends both on the radionuclide and the source model. That is why I was telling you that there are different source models that are available. So we need to be very careful about what radionuclide are we using and which model we are using. So even within iridium also, there are 4 or 5 sources from different manufacturers. And it is important that we pick up the right dose rate constant. And it also depends on the source internal design and the experimental methodology used by the primary standard to realize the air karma strength. So what does it mean? It means that it is the dose rate to water at a distance of 1 meter on the transverse axis per unit air karma strength of the source in water. And it accounts for the effects of soil geometry, spatial distribution of radioactivity within the source encapsulation, filtration of the source, and also scattering in water surrounding the tissue. The next important point is factor is the geometric function. It accounts for the geometric falloff of the photon fluence with the distance r. The purpose of geometric function is to improve the accuracy with which the dose rates can be estimated by interpolation from the data tabulator at discrete points. Physically, the geometry function neglects scattering and attenuation, and it provides an effective inverse square law correction based on an approximate model of the spatial distribution of radioactivity within the source. And because the geometry function is used to interpolate between the tabulated dose rate values at defined points, highly simplistic approximations yield sufficient accuracy for treatment planning. So we need to have a good a geometric function so that we do not suffer from the approximations. The next is the radial dose function. It accounts for the effects of attenuation in scatter and water. The radial dose function, it accounts for the scatter, attenuation and scatter and water. It is also influenced by filtration of photons by the encapsulation in other materials. Again, as I was telling, the radial dose function depends on the radionuclide, the source model, and also the geometry. The anisotropic function accounts for the anisotropy of dose distribution around the source, including the effects of absorption of scatter in water. So you can see that here there is a small dip here. And if you recall the source design, there was this welding that was used to weld the source capsule and the cable. And that produces attenuation, which need to be accounted during dose calculation. And so anisotropic function was introduced. I'm not going into the details of this. Maybe I think you can go through it later because it is quite self-explanatory. Now let us come to the most important part of the beauty therapy from the revision oncology perspective. Let us take a case example of cervical cancer. There are various historical systems that are available, and it is very important that we know about these historical systems also. They are called Manchester system, Paris system, Fletcher system, and Stockholm system. Paris system is specifically defined for intracavitary. And based on the rules of the loading of the sources, and these systems are, the system vary a little bit. So this is the historical Paris system. Here, the intracavitary applicator consisted of a rubber tandem in the uterine cavity and a pair of cork colpostats coated with the paraffin. The colpostats were not connected with the, and the distance between them was not fixed. Now you can see they are independent. The system was manually preloaded with the radium sources earlier. And the amount of radium is depends on how much that you wanted to deliver. Let's say, for example, typically if you wanted to deliver 7,000 to 8,000 milligram, then the patient would lie down with the applicator for 5 days, which will last for about 120 hours. So that's really quite low dose. And typically, if you want to compare it, it will be like 50 centigrade per hour. So that is the dose rate that you're working with. And this is a classical Stockholm system, where you can see that the applicator consists of a flexible intrauterine tube and a vaginal part, which was a flat box or a plate that was inserted into the vagina and pushed against the posterior. Like in Paris technique, the intrauterine tube and the plate were not connected here. So they were again not connected. And so there's no fixed geometry. The intrauterine tube and the vaginal plate were manually preloaded again with radium. So these are all preloaded techniques. And similarly, you can see that unlike in Paris system, where the patient has to lie down for 120 hours continuously, here you have 2 to 3 applications, and every application would last for about 20 to 30 hours. And this is one of the most popular system, we call it Manchester system. And there they have now applicator is now fixed applicator, so the geometry is maintained. So that is one advantage. And second important thing is that there are certain set of rules that are defined. The first rule is that how much of radium that you can put in intrauterine source and how much of radium that you can put in vaginal sources. So even now today for high dose of brachytherapy, we use these loading patterns. And to be very specific, the ratio of the loading in uterine to the vaginal sources, it is generally 1. Although with the new advanced optimization, some kind of deviation is accepted, but not a big deviation. The next is the Fletcher suit applicator. Again, one of the most commonly used even today. It is introduced in the 50s. Fletcher, this is a US system. Who developed it originally consisted of a rigid metallic intrauterine tandem of different curvature with a flange of flange for length adjustment for the uterus. And this is one of the fixed geometry that was introduced. So even today we are using these applicators. Subsequently, there was a lot of modification that have happened over the applicators. Let us say you can see these are the various new applicators made up of you can see they are quite thick applicators used for cesium-137 loading. And then later on, they became small and miniature, and which were designed for iridium-192. Now, we have modern applicators. You can see these are all the new applicators, which are not made up of stainless steel materials. So there are two major, I would say, development that have happened in terms of applicator. One is the applicator material has changed. And second thing, they have introduced new imaging modalities. So here you can see historically we used to use radiographs, and then later on we came to CT. But now we have MRI where you will be able to see the tumor very clearly. And not only to see the tumor, we also have new tools to guide our dose distribution based on that. So this is kind of a paradigm shift that has happened in the last decade in brachytherapy, especially in cervical cancer. So for you to understand what are the benefits of modern 3D image-based brachytherapy, you need to understand what are the limitations of historical brachytherapy system. So let us understand first the historical 2D image-based brachytherapy, and then we will move towards the 3D image-based brachytherapy for cervical cancer. So if you see, I'm sure that most of you have seen these pictures. This is an AP view of a brachytherapy applicator inserted. This is inserted into the uterine cavity, and this is the vaginal mucosis. So what are the advantages of this system? So one is that you can get a good view of the applicator and its source positions. And you can also see there are certain points that are located here. And these points are the surrogate points for the organs at risk. Let's say, for example, these are the points that are surrogates for the rectum. And these are the surrogate points for bladder. And then we don't see the tumor here. The dosimetry was based on point A. And I think you have to go back and check what's point A, because this is quite easily available literature material from everywhere. And this has been quite reasonably uniform across the world, and it has been time tested. Now you might ask, what is the limitation of this? This is quite good. The limitation is that, first thing is that we are not able to see the residual disease at the time of brachytherapy. And because of that, there were a lot of failures. So we wanted to definitely see what is the target. On the other hand, you can see, you cannot see the uterus. You cannot see the anterior bladder wall or the posterior bladder wall or the sigmoid or the small bubble. Because of these inabilities, when you get the patient after brachytherapy, when the patient is bleeding from the, let's say, rectum wall or upper rectum, or sometimes the patient even bleed from the bowel, or patient might recur. And because of these reasons, we are not able to correlate what doses that we have delivered and what doses that we have delivered versus the clinical outcome. So we definitely wanted to see what we wanted to deliver. And so we were able to get the new imaging modalities. This is going to be, again, another just additional information that we cannot completely write off the historical practice. Yes, we have introduced new imaging modalities in terms of MRI. Yes, we have new applicators material which are CT or MRI compatible. At the same time, the historical dosimetry systems have given us a lot of information, both in terms of local control and in toxicity, especially the ICRU rectal reference point, which we were practicing, correlates very well with the new dose volume parameter, which is the D2CC volumetric parameter of the organ rectum. And so even today in modern brachytherapy, using MRI image-based brachytherapy also, we try to use the ICRU rectal point, although now it's called the ICRU rectovaginal point. However, the bladder point is not very representative. It underestimates, but we continue to report. And there are also not good the sigmoid representation, because in 2D brachytherapy, you will not be able to see sigmoid in orthogonal radiographs. And most of the patients that we see in our clinic during the 2D era is the bleeding from the upper rectum, from the sigmoid. So it is important that we know that we must know what are the doses that we are delivering. And in 2D brachytherapy, there is no way that you will be able to correlate. So this is one such example, that one study that we have done in our department, where we did not find any correlation to find a point where we can correlate in orthogonal radiograms. So we were actually trying to find a point, like how a rectal point or bladder point is there. We were trying to see if we are able to get a point for the sigmoid so that we'll be able to use that point for those who are practicing the orthogonal image-based radiograph. But unfortunately, there was no agreement that among these points. So we must use some form of axial images to estimate the dose to be sigmoid. So there is this famous comparison of 2D versus 3D comparison just to sensitize of why we should move on to 3D and give up on 2D, but this transition has to be safe. So this is the study that was performed in Denmark. You can see these are all the 2D standard plans. And this is the D90 of high-risk CTV. That is the representative of the target dose in 3D. And this is the D2CC, that is the representative of the organs at risk dose of sigmoid, bladder, and rectum. Now you can see there are some lines here that divides this graph into four quadrants. So this area, the quadrant one, this area is less dose to the tumor and less dose to the organ, which is not desirable. This quadrant represents high dose to the tumor and less dose to the normal tissue, which is the most desirable one. And this quadrant represents high dose to both tumor and target, which is again not desirable. And this quadrant represents less dose to target and more dose to organs. So here also, this also is not desirable. So the what is important is that we need to remain in this quadrant. So you can see these are the 2D standard plans. They're scattered everywhere. But however, when we move on to 3D, so this is 10 out of 57 patients are in the 2D plan. But when we move to 3D optimized plans, you can see that more and more patients are falling into the safe zone. So this is the power of 3D optimization, both using imaging and also advanced applicators. So from 10 out of 57, now we can see when you're using 3D optimization, we have 44 out of 57 patients meeting all the dose constraints of both the target and opposite risk. So when we are talking about the transition, what is more important is the volume. So how do we understand this graph? You can see that this is the volume of high-risk CTV and this is the D90, that is the dose that we are delivering. Maybe I think we need a separate lecture to understand each and terminology, but I'm just trying to let you know that what is important. So this is also a take-home message that not all patients require advanced 3D image-based brachytherapy. It all depends on how much of volume, residual volume at the time of brachytherapy is there and how we are going to approach. So that is what decides that what kind of modality that you have to use when you're practicing the image-based brachytherapy for cervical cancer. So here you can see for smaller volumes, you are delivering a very high dose. And only for higher volumes, you are delivering low dose. So this represents the threshold dose that we have to deliver. So it's very important that you need to optimize so that you reduce the dose to the volume for low, small volume tumors and increase the dose that you're delivering to the big tumors. So this is the power of optimization, that irrespective of the tumor volume, you are able to increase. And these small little triangles that you see is the use of additional interstitial needles we're able to deliver. So this is the power of optimization, and that gives you the justification of why you have to move to 2D to 3D. In the interest of time, I think I'm just skipping these slides now. From the radiation perspective, radiation safety perspective, I think there are some things that we need to also understand. not only the physicists, but also the entire radiation oncologist community who are working with the brachytherapy. So I think I would like to just give you some more important information about the radiation safety. The emergency handling procedure must be known to everybody, although the radiation safety officer is present, but each and everybody who is working with the radioactive sources must know what is the safety mechanism or retraction of the sources in emergency situation. Let's say, for example, you're treating a patient and then the source is not going back. And there is nothing to panic, and you should know what is the procedure that you must do. So tomorrow when you go back to your department, just go and check where are these emergency buttons and what is the procedure to get the source back into the source safe. So it is very important that all of us know what is the safety mechanism to retract the sources in case of emergency, irrespective of the stream that you belong to, whether you're an RTT or a medical physicist or a radiation oncologist. So typically what you do is that, of course, it's a very highly unlikely situation, and but it can happen, and it has happened. It may have happened due to the kink in the catheter, or sometimes the applicators, if you prolong use of applicators also might create problems. This must be done by a suitably trained person. But however, having said that, there's nothing wrong that the treating radiation oncologist is aware of the emergency procedures that are being followed. And also there are all these safety mechanisms that you must keep in mind. So these are some of the screenshots that I picked it up from the source is out of safe, in safe. So keep your eyes and ears open and see how the source is traveling. And when the source is active, you must see that it is out of safe, and these indicators are active. There are certain standard operating procedures that at the time of treating patient, the physicist or the radiation safety officer or the RTT does. But I think you also must aware of these things. So there are certain daily checks for its functionality and all these things that we do. There are also a certain test that we do for the timer. Everything depends on the time. So if the timer fails, then everything is going to fail. So timer, I think, is going to be one of the most important factor quality assurance checks that we do. So in the morning, we do a timer check and also the source positioning accuracy check. The gamma zone monitor in every remote afterloader machine, you will see this gamma zone monitor. So when the patient treatment is over, it is important to check that the zone and the survey meters used in the treatment room are in working condition and also properly calibrated. I mean, of course, it is not your job to calibrate, but you can always check whether they are working, because these are very well viewed from outside through the CCTV monitors, and you can always just be alert and check whether these are properly working or not. Communication system is extremely important, because in my experience, I have seen many times that during the treatment, the patients, removing the catheters for whatever reason, and in case if you're treating pediatric patients, then they are not cooperating. So there are various scenarios where communication equipment is extremely important, both audio and video. And we must have these equipments in place, and also constant monitoring is important to avoid accidents. These are very important, because I just wanted to again emphasize that being brachytherapy users, we also need to know what tools we are using. Because many times I have seen that, let's say the physicist or the RTT is not there, and if the physician or the resident is connecting, they just do the incorrect connection, and because of that, there will be a lot of interruption in the sources. So we need to also know that what tools are using and which tube needs to be used for which connector. And these are although very small technical parameters, I think it is always good to know. I'm skipping this. Finally, it's very important also to get the patient compliance. It's a very key feature of any good brachytherapy procedure. Patient must be well informed of the procedure, including the side effects. I'm sure that as physicians, you take the consent, but especially for brachytherapy, the special consent is required because it involves, invasive procedure. And you also would see that the source drums in the source afterloader rooms. You might be wondering, what is this? These are the emergency containers that are positioned always in the room as a part of the regulatory aspect. Because in case if the source falls off, or in case if the source gets stuck or something, it is recommended that you press the emergency button so that the source go back, or remove the applicator from the patient and then put it inside the source container so that it will not be so that radiation exposure is minimized. And this is the source container that is used at the time of source change in high-dose brachytherapy. And whenever you have time, maybe I think it's preferable that you just go and have a look at once, and it's interesting to know. And also another important thing in brachytherapy, I have seen one of the common errors that we do is the transfer tube sources of the patient are getting interchanged. You see all these colors, they are red in color, and then you can see one plane is green in color. So we should not mix up the channels, and that might cause a serious accident. As I was telling earlier, in brachytherapy, the dose distribution is governed by only inverse square law. Although you have the anisotropic factor or geometry function or radial function, but the predominant factor is inverse square law. And so if we mix up these channels, you might end up having different doses at different dwell times that will lead to catastrophic effects. Well, we have almost come to the end of the conclusion. To complete the presentation, I would just like to go through some of the MCQs that we prepared. So let us go through the first question. In TG43 formalism, what is the specification of source strength? A, activity. B, apparent activity. C, air karma strength. D, reference air karma rate. So you can just see activity and apparent activity is out. Although air karma strength and reference air karma rate are the same, it is air karma strength because in TG43 that was used to know to express the source strength in terms of at a shorter distances. And reference air karma rate is defined at 1 meter. All right. So next question is, which is a classical system designed applicators and their loading to enable the same dose rate point A regardless of which combination of applicators are used? Manchester system, Paris system, Stockholm system, or Fletcher system? So I told you that Paris system, Stockholm are systems where you will have the intrauterine tandem and the vaginal sources are not connected. But Fletcher and Manchester, they are connected. And Fletcher is one of the most popular system where this point was introduced, point A was introduced. And because of that, a uniform form of reporting has come. So the answer for this question is obviously A. The next question, this is again a physics related question, which of the following function accounts for the attenuation and scatter in TG43 formalism? So is this the dose rate constant? No, dose rate constant is not the one. Second is the anisotropy function. Third is the radial dose function. D is the geometry function. So anisotropy function accounts for the source anisotropy due to source welding and all that. And geometry function accounts for the geometry factor. And radial dose function accounts for the attenuation and the scatter. And dose rate constant is specific for a particular source and the type. So the answer for this question is C. The next is another interesting question. Which of the following statement is correct? ICRU rectal point correlates well with the D2CC rectum. ICRU bladder point correlates well with the D2CC of the bladder. Sigmoid dose points can be identified in 2D brachytherapy, or none of the above. So A is ICRU rectal point correlates well with the D2CC is the right one. And that is why even the new ICRU 89 also recommends the ICRU point, although now it's called rectovaginal point. Bladder point does not correlate very well. And I don't know if you got it correctly. I was very quick to explain this slide. Sigmoid points do not correlate with any 2D radiographs. So the answer to this question is A. So rectum is very important. Even if you are doing 2D radiograph or 3D or whatever, the rectum point, the historical rectum points holds good even now. Finally, which of the following property is the incorrect statement regarding iridium 192 source? So one is the source exchange happens every 4 to 5 months. High specific activity. Photon energy do not require high shielding, require thick encapsulation. So you can see source exchange every 4 to 5 months is the right answer. High specific activity, and because of that, we were able to get the source in a miniature size. And photon energy do not require high shielding. On the other hand, cobalt 60 requires high shielding, and it does not require thick encapsulation. So the correct answer to this question is D. So with that, we have come to the conclusion of this presentation. And you can see these references. You can see Khan, FM Khan book, and also the Jackie Stroh handbook of brachytherapy, and also the practical guide to quality control of brachytherapy, that is ISTRO booklet 8. And these, as I was telling earlier, these are the IAEA slides. It's a course which is called 2D to 3D transition of brachytherapy, taking the cervical cancer as an example. And this is only the first lecture. And they are freely downloadable, and you can go and look up, and they are self-explanatory. And I hope that I am able to convey, in this 1 hour, whatever the short overview of brachytherapy, taking cervical cancer as an example. Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you, madam, for that excellent deliberation regarding the physics of HDR brachytherapy. I would now request the participants to post their questions in the chat box. So, madam, the first question is, please emphasize on the clinical significance of D.1cc and D2cc.
Okay. They correlate with the different clinical endpoints. Like, for example, D.1cc correlates with fistula, and D2cc correlates with other endpoints such as, proctitis, bleeding. So there are also newer endpoints that are coming up for intermediate bladder doses, like, frequency of urination and all that. So these are different endpoints for different doses. So as of now, we have evidence for D.1cc, D2cc. So these two are mandatory according to ICAR UGMN.
Okay, madam. Are there any more questions? So if any of one of you have any questions, please write it on the chat box. The reference volume, I think this has been discussed previously in the brachytherapy class taken by Supriya Madam. So kindly refer to that video on YouTube where Madam has brilliantly explained the utility or the usefulness of the reference volume, the 60 gray reference volume.
Each module that we have covered is actually, we need to discuss more in the law break. For example, TG43 itself will take, about 1 to 2 hours of time. And then 2D brachytherapy and how optimization is helped. So this is again another 4 to 5 hours. So it is, I don't think I would have done justice to this 1 hour. But this to brachytherapy, you need to go back and sit and meditate upon what on the slides. I'm sure that you will appreciate the power of brachytherapy, especially in the treatment of cervical cancer.
We completely agree, madam. And the video will be available on YouTube, so you can read up the topic and then come back and see the video once again to have a better grasp. I don't think there are any more questions. So thank you, madam, for that excellent class. We look forward to having you for further classes when we plan for more such sessions.
Thank you.
So, thank you, madam. Thank you, all the participants. We meet again tomorrow because there'll be some changes. So this week we have 3 consecutive classes on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. So he'll be updated on the various groups on WhatsApp messages regarding the next classes. Till then, goodbye and good night.